Hello friends, welcome back to Tech with Viresh. So in the continuation to our series on Apache Spark deep dive, today we'll pick up a very interesting and a very common topic, which is what is the difference between cache and persist APIs given by the Spark UI? What is the difference between the two APIs and where should we use which one? And we'll try to take a look on these two APIs with the help of the Spark UI. Spark UI will give us the right information that what is happening behind the scene when you call cache or when you call persist. So guys, let's start. So at a very high level, the cache API doesn't take any parameter, but it is equivalent to the persist API with storage level as memory only. So your cache API is nothing but a wrapper on top of your persistent API with the default storage level as memory only. While on the other hand, if I talk about the persist API, it gives you a flexibility to pass in the parameter about what is the storage level where you want to save those RDDs and data frames. So we'll talk about storage level in a bit in detail, what are the different storage levels available in the Apache Spark world. But this is the relation, correlation, or the difference between the two APIs. Now we'll look it forward. So the only difference that we have found between the two APIs, as we have already discussed, is about the storage level. So in cache, storage level is fixed as default. What we have as is storage level memory only. Now let's quickly look at the five storage levels provided by the Apache Spark world. The first one is the memory only, which is the default when we call the cache API. So in this storage level, RDD or data frame is stored as deserialized Java object in the JVM or in the heap memory of the JVM, right? So what will happen when we set the storage level as memory only, the object will go in your JVM heap memory. And if in case that object doesn't fit into the memory, it's a big object, it's not getting fit into the assigned allocated memory, then that data will not spill onto the disk, whether that portion partitions of the data would be left out and would be recalculated whenever the further processing or the action would be called. So whatever can fit into the memory, that that part of the object or those partitions of the object would be stored in the heap, right? Now the next one is the memory and disk, right? It supplements the first one. Whatsoever can come in the memory will go into the heap memory, and whatever would be the remaining partitions and the remaining data would spill onto the disk, right? And the third one is the memory only ser. Ser means serialized. In the above two cases, the data was object was stored as deserialized. So when the data is deserialized, the size of the object would be comparatively a little bigger, while if it is serialized, it will be more compact. And as the name says, memory only, it will only go into the memory. Rest of the data partitions would be calculated again when the action would be called. The fourth one is the memory and disk ser, same as the point number B. Here the only difference is the object would be stored in the serialized form. So you will get the benefit of memory saving. The size of the serialized object is comparatively compact, smaller than the deserialized one. And the last one is the disk only. As the name suggests, in this case, the data or the RAD data frame would be saved on the disk, right? So these are the five storage level provided by the Apache Spark. Let's try to run it through an example, and let's validate it through the Spark UI. Whatever the concepts we're talking about, is it actually true? Let's validate it with the Spark UI. So I've created a small program, right? There's some data frames with the random numbers. It's a single column with 50 rows. This is one of the very useful way to create data frames while doing the innate testing of the source code. And if you're optimizing or building or committing to the Spark stuff. And then what we did here, we created a data frame 2. And we call the cache API on that. So as per the concept, cache should only store the object onto the memory. It should not spill onto the disk. Let's try to verify it from this Spark UI. So if you go to the storage tab of the Spark UI for that job, you will see that I have one object which is stored, and if you see here, it is deserialized and it is on the memory. So see, nothing on the disk, 0 KB on the disk, right? Everything is in the memory, and it also shows the fraction cached. So it shows 100%. That means all the data has been able to accommodate in the memory allocated. So the 100% data we are able to save in the memory. If in case it won't be able to save everything into the memory, it will give you the fraction, that how much data is saved. Else would be calculated, as we discussed, when any action or further processing would happen. So it confirms to the fact that by default caches memory and the deserialized object, right? Now let's try to call the persistent API. Same example, we try to call the persistent API, and this time we explicitly make the storage level as disk only. So as per the concept, this time everything should be on the disk, nothing should be in the memory for as far as this particular data frame is concerned. Again, we'll go to the Spark UI, and if we see it, this is the second one. This is disk serialized, right? And everything is on the disk. And if you see, size on the memory is 0 KB. And again, it shows it's 100%, correct? So it proves the concept that we discussed in the theory, right? That when we are explicitly calling persist with storage level, it acknowledges that, and the entire data when we called persist with storage level as disk went to the disk. So guys, that's it in this particular video. Sometime we may get confused with this concept, but just have to make sure that persist and cache both are same. The only difference is with cache, the default storage level would come into the picture, and that is memory only. And when you say memory only, the object is stored in the deserialized form on the JVM heap memory. So guys, that's it in this particular video. Have a great day ahead. Bye bye.